Simon Schaffer.
What I think is so striking is that a lot of the relatively elite intellectual response to the appearance of plebeian unbelief in cheap print is not so much that these are false arguments, but that they're dangerous arguments. Since it's agreed on all hands that knowledge is power, giving power and giving the power of materialism and naturalism to large sectors of the labouring classes was judged to be very dangerous. And one does see in the 1820s in England, for example, folk who are, as it were, elite atheists, who argue that there is no rational evidence for the existence of God, that you don't have to ground morality on faith in God's existence, but that it would be socially fatal for everybody to know that. There's a sense in which there's always been a social heft to the debate about atheism in Britain. That there are ideas it's safe to contemplate, but not safe to publish and make widely available.
All churches, whether Jewish, Christian or Muslim, appear to me no other than human inventions set up to terrify and enslave mankind and to monopolize power and profit.
Paine left the United States and traveled to Paris. He was welcomed and, extraordinarily, elected to the Revolutionary National Assembly. The French revolutionaries closed down churches across the whole country, and the Bishop of Paris was forced to declare himself a charlatan. And yet the revolution was not, strictly speaking, atheist. Robespierre, for example, insisted on the existence of some kind of supreme being. A fete or festival was dedicated to this supreme being. But it's questionable how seriously this was taken when you hear stories that it was a Paris prostitute who was crowned the goddess of reason here in the deconsecrated church now called the Pantheon. Paine may have supported the revolution, but since he was opposed to the execution of the French king, he was imprisoned and only narrowly escaped the guillotine. And there was no welcome for such a skeptical revolutionary in England. So he returned to America, to the farm he'd been given by that grateful nation. Ironically, his religious skepticism was now something of an embarrassment to many Americans, and he died unmourned and more or less ignored in New York in 1809.
Thomas Paine needs no monument made of hands. He has erected a monument in the hearts of all lovers of liberty.
Political philosophy. However, the government realized that radicalism and atheism went hand in hand, and they were determined to fight them both. Richard Carlyle was actually imprisoned for publishing an atheistic and politically subversive journal called The Republican. His crime? Blasphemous and seditious libel. His journal carried on under the editorship of his wife, but she was also imprisoned. And then his sister, but she was also imprisoned. Indeed, 150 people were imprisoned for publishing and selling The Republican. And between them, they served a total of 200 years in jail. In fact, one of The Republican's most distinguished contributors was the romantic poet Percy Bysshe Shelley, who had been sent down from Oxford for writing a pamphlet called The Necessity of Atheism.
If he is infinitely good, what reason should we have to fear him? If he is infinitely wise, why should we have doubts concerning our future? If he knows all, why warn him of our needs and fatigue him with our prayers? If he is everywhere, Why erect temples to him?
Oxford University was unfortunately not prepared to see Shelley's work as a promising philosophical treatise.
The purport of Darwin's theory was, in order to make a perfect and beautiful machine, it is not requisite to know how to make it. And it was this inversion of reasoning that was so dangerous, because it turned everything upside down in a way. It suggested that we could have a bottom-up theory of creative genius rather than a top-down, rather than a trickle-down theory, which depended on an intelligent artificer. The basic idea is so simple that you have variation, that inevitably, if there's variation in the population, some are going to be better than others, and the ones that are better than others are going to have more kids than the ones, than the less favored ones, and the offspring are going to resemble their parents. And most of the skepticism over the century plus that we've had since Darwin proposed this idea has been along the lines of, well, there's just too much work to be done by such a simple process.
But the newly discovered billions of years in the Earth's history gave plenty of time for Darwin's slow evolutionary process to work. And believers in God simply had to accept that they might have a problem.
Darwin's discovery of natural selection is the first time that a scientific idea subverts one of the principal arguments in favor of God, because it dispenses with the idea of design. Well, his theory has a certain sort of elegance, because wherever you observe life, although its efficiency is undoubtedly startling, the developments are sort of gimcrack. They're improvised. They're put together without a view to an outcome. In fact, when you come to think of it, the word improvise is rather unfortunate and misleading, because it makes it look as if something is blundering its way towards a conclusion, whereas nothing is blundering its way towards anything. There's no mentality at work here. There's no conscious object in view. The process, for example, of getting bits and pieces of the jaw of ancient reptiles into the inner ear of modern mammals, bones which enable them to hear, is not one that took place because something foresaw that those bones might come in handy as a hearing device. Hearing simply emerged as an unintended consequence of the unsolicited variations. Established church was appalled by the theory of evolution because it denied the very idea of an inaugural creation in which all natural forms had been established from the outset. And as far as the clergy were concerned, what was even more shocking was the idea that man was included in this process, and that as a mere descendant of apes, he had lost his curious spirit.
Secularism was hugely popular throughout the 19th century, and the National Secular Society still exists in the 21st century here in Conway Hall in London. After Holyoke, the leadership of the secular societies fell to Charles Bradlaugh, a radical MP famous for being expelled from Parliament and briefly locked in the Tower of London for his failure as an atheist to swear on the Bible his oath of allegiance. Bradlaugh secured the right, which we still enjoy, for every man and woman in this country to affirm an oath rather than having to swear on the Bible.
Nobody spends their time trying to prove to others that the Greek gods don't exist. You know, you just decide that they don't, and that's the end of the story for you. So I like to distinguish atheism from anti-theism. Anti-theism is opposition to theism. I am an anti-theist because I believe that religion is harmful. I'm not just an atheist who something my only values are that I don't agree with it. I'm actively opposed to it. But then I distinguish that from what I call post-theism or post-atheism, which is the healthy state of mind, where you've put all that behind you. Now, we can't do that yet because there's lots of religion in the world and lots of bad results of it. But to me, the ideal society would be one in which the question of religion didn't really arise for people, or if it did, it wasn't a heavy question for them. they would say to each other, you know, those humans used to believe back there in 2003, some of them believed there was this God and he did this, others didn't, and they were, did TV programs about why they didn't. What a funny debate that was, you know. So it would be a post-theist society where it wasn't an issue.